Welcome to the Challenges of Change, the podcast where we explore the transformative journey towards self-improvement and personal growth. I'm your host, Laura, a mindset coach in the health and fitness industry, here to guide you through the hurdles that life throws at you. In each episode, we'll delve into practical strategies and insightful discussions to help you manage stress, regulate your emotions, upgrade your mindset, and ultimately reclaim your sense of worth. I'm thrilled to have you join me on this journey of change, challenges, and self-discovery. So I have something very special in store for you. I happened to capture a rare moment of me coaching Coach Jess. We got on a call. It was our intention to do the podcast, but I was circling back around a few action steps that I'd given her from some of the previous coaching. And that kind of took our meeting in a different direction. And we just happened to be recording because we were planning on doing the podcast. And when we closed the podcast, Coach Jess gave me permission to share her experience of being coached. And it's something I was very uncertain around because I do believe that coaching is a kind of sacred space and I want to respect that. But I often find that people don't understand what coaching is. So hopefully you can grab some insights from our conversation and get a better idea of what coaching is and maybe even learn a thing or two in some similar struggles that you might have. So enjoy.
How do you trap yourself or limit your freedom in coaching? And this is what came to me is doing everything the right way.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So in my mind, and this is, you can tell it's conditioning because it is definitely on repeat back there, right? And it bleeds into a lot of my life. I'm very critical of things. I like things done. I like things organized. I like things aesthetically pleasing. I like the dishwasher to be done just so. Things like that. So I like things being done the right way. And that is an echo of my dad.
Mm-hmm.
And then next question is, well, what does that protect? And it protects me from the criticism.
Mm-hmm.
There's an imaginary person criticizing me all the time, except they're in my head.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So if you do everything, so you trap yourself by feeling like you need to do everything right to protect yourself from being criticized by yourself.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm writing down Facebook right now because I just had that link, right? So the reason I don't like to go on Facebook is there's a lot of criticism out there. A lot of it. It's almost, sometimes I feel like that's all it is criticism.
I get that. There's plenty of evidence for that.
Yeah, and so it feels very toxic to me.
Okay. So if I don't say the right thing or write the right thing, I'll be criticized.
Yeah, if I use the wrong word, even it gets down to that level.
Yeah.
So I edit and re-edit and re-edit and reread and reread and reread.
Okay. What would you do if you weren't afraid, but rather free and in flow?
So this one is I would believe in myself and my ability to learn as I grow.
So here's the beauty of being a coach and the curse. You know how to repattern it, right? What do you want to do when you notice, like, you gave me a bunch of great, like, red flag warning signs. Like, if you're noticing criticism, if you're being really specific about how things need to be, or if you're bothered by a lack of aesthetics, like, these are warning signs that something's wrong, right?
Mm. Yeah, actually, I didn't even make that connection. But, yeah, that is a signal when I start to get persnickety.
Yes. So, like, what do you want to, like, how do you want to be conscious in your own mind to help retrain that?
is a sign. How do I want to retrain that? Well, I noticed that it is a fear of criticism. So that's fear loading up. And usually when you're trying to protect fear, you're doing something wildly, right? So you're probably not going to get the best results out of it. Where my brain goes initially. But to believe in myself and my ability to learn as I grow, maybe I need to, something says that I need to redefine my relationship with criticism.
I like that voice.
Yeah, I know. And then the other part of me is like, oh, Jess, more research.
Which you love.
I know.
Maybe it's not even the relationship, just your understanding of criticism.
Yeah, like part of me was like, well, what's the good part of criticism? We obviously embraced it for a reason. And then because it's all bad, right? As soon as I see, hear, think criticism, I'm like, oh.
Yeah,
I
that's how I
don't
have with
know.
judgment, because I had the negative association growing up with judgment. And now I recognize, I call it appraisal. I actually don't use judgment anymore with myself. Same thing, like I don't use the word lazy with myself anymore. I just kicked it out because it had too many connotations. And I understand where because I don't judge people, but when I sense judgment, I'm like, that's their appraisal. It's not a bad thing, because I had so much negativity around judgment growing up that anytime I sense others judging me, I'm like, that's their appraisal and it's about them. And I just let it be that. So like, maybe it's about understanding or even rewording what criticism is. Like, maybe it's the, you got this? Like, is this your second stamp of approval? Like, things don't look okay.
Yeah.
Are we all right?
I definitely want to play with it and
Yeah.
see how I can expand my, and when I say my relationship, really what I'm talking about there, right, is how I feel when I experience or even when I label something as criticism, right? When my brain says that's criticism, how do I feel in my body in that moment? Do I feel tight? Do I feel squirmy, you know, or can I sit there and be like, oh yeah, criticism, okay.
I think that's brilliant. I have hypotheses, but I will let you totally discover that. I might even encourage you to redefine or clarify what right is.
Oh. Yeah, that's like an ongoing thing. That takes a while. I'm in the middle of that but it starts so small. It starts so small. Like for example, I love going to the dishwasher thing. For me, it's like, ah, it's like an irritation. It's not a high level one, so it's easier to talk about. But I want it done the right way. I like to be efficient and maximize the space in there, but also make sure all my dishes are getting clean.
I get it. I had the same thing when I moved in with Scott, and then I couldn't even get him to put dishes in the dishwasher. Finally, he did, and then I was telling him he was doing it wrong, and it created conflict. So I folded. I decided to value my relationship more than the organization of the or efficiency of the dishwasher. There are moments it bothers me still, but
Good.
that's my bother to deal with, not to put on.
So imagine our newest setup, and the one that's been working the best so far is that Dad does all the dishes. I don't think he sets as an efficient in my mind, right? This is the voice. I don't think that he sets the dishwasher efficiently, but when he says he's going to do all the dishes and I never have to worry about them and they're his job and that's it, I learned to be like, what? All right, do them as you will then, sir.
So maybe it's about when is it okay for things to not be done the right way?
Yeah, and so that whole thing and why I use that example so much, it was such a learning experience for me that I'm so okay
Yeah.
with the dishwasher being done like that. Even though in the moment when I would watch it, and even now sometimes if I see it, right? I'll feel that old feeling kind of creeping up like, ooh, I don't like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, But I've learned that that thing doesn't have to be all encompassing. It doesn't have to be like such an irritation that it has to change or I won't feel better.
I think that's fantastic. What does the right way mean to you when it comes to like socials or posting or writing?
Yeah, so that one came up a lot when I was like trying to figure out what how it is I hold my back help self back. And so I tend to I tend to want to word things properly because I want them to be right. I want the right tone and voice to come through, and I know how hard that is in writing, especially short blurbs. I'll give you an example. Like my worst nightmare has already happened. I wrote up something, and the intent and purpose behind it was to compare what it costs to eat well and take care of yourself, and what it costs to be really, really sick. So I just compare this, and in that I use my own experience of hospital bills, my interaction with the healthcare system on that end. Before I was in it. And then I got to experience what it was like to be in it by having a baby and then having cancer. And those bills added up. And so I use my cancer bills as an example of how much that can add up when you get really sick. And it triggered somebody. It triggered them, and they were like, "You can't cure cancer with eating well. I'm proof of that." And it kind of like hit me like, oh no, you know what I mean? I had this one intention and it definitely hit somebody the wrong way in a way that I did not intend. And it was very apparent. And it was also, and also in my mind, I'm like, and how is that going to make, if somebody reads my thing, they might get the point that I'm trying to get. But then when that person makes that comment, they'll go, oh, I didn't even think of it that way. Is that what she meant? So it made me like a little nervous. I didn't want other people to take it the wrong way because on that platform, it's so visible, other people's thoughts, attacks, and self and unconscious commenting.
Do you believe that the brain filters information and chooses what to absorb based on what we believe about ourselves?
Hold on, you're gonna have to say that question again.
Okay. Do you believe the brain filters like the data we get from the day and only absorbs the data that confirms what we believe?
I believe that wholeheartedly. I know that to be true.
Okay. So it's not about what you say then, because people are always filtering anything you write, say, speak, words, any of it through their filters and absorbing whatever words or non-words are there to confirm their beliefs. Right?
That's right.
So it's a two-truth situation. That's going to be very uncomfortable. Every time it happens, it's going to be
Every time.
very uncomfortable. And that's good. It's good because it means care. And
Okay.
sadly, a lot of people who agree don't go in the comments and say, I agree, thanks for sharing. They heart it and move on, right?
Yeah.
But I think you need, like, the thing that's popping up for me, and I'm going to shift us in a second, but is generalizations for reals in like the sense of the right way. Right way according to who? Like you can say everything the right way according to you, and it will be misinterpreted 50 million other different ways.
Right.
Because it's never about how you say or what you say. It's about their beliefs, their distortions, and their filter.
Right.
Right?
So then we're pointing exactly at what holds me back from posting and public marketing when I write is that I can't use that hyperbole. I can't say this is the right way to do something because in my mind, I'm like, that's not, it's the right way for you to do something. It's not the right way for everybody to do something. You need to clarify that. You're not being honest and truthful and transparent. And then I get a little long, and then I got to tighten it up. And then I got, you know, and it just creates this back and forth. It's a very uncomfortable position for me to be in. But the only thing that helps me persevere through it is that I'm really trying to get a good message out.
And I think your process is slowly evolving as it needs to. And I encourage you to remember people are always interpreting things through their lens. Even if you said the right way, or even if you don't say the right way, they're going to interpret it as this is the only way. You didn't say this is the only way to cure cancer. You said this is my experience. Someone else filtered, interpreted, distorted, implied only, and chose to get offended.
Yeah.
And like, constant, like when that happens, it's never going to feel good. And that's a good thing because it means you care. That is very, very true. And you can't let that stop you from all the people who do need to hear that message, who do need to understand it, because you're going to piss people off. You're going to get, if you're going to persevere and try and have an impact, make yourself public, people are going to hate on you because people don't know how to manage themselves, so they like to hate on others.
I don't think she hates me. She still likes all of my stuff, and we have a call scheduled after she gets back from Spain.
I mean, hate on you, as in like say negative comments, criticize, etc. Because people don't know how to regulate themselves.
Yeah. Yeah, so I dipped my toe in. I got to feel it. Luckily, it was with somebody extremely nice and caring. And she's like, and she openly admitted, she's like, I might be being sensitive. And I was like, it's okay. That's fine. Like, I understand.
Yeah.
I just
and
wanted
that's how you handle it. That's great.
Because I wanted to tell her, I was like, look, you know, we had like a back and forth on the thing. And so I private messaged her and I said, hey, just make sure, because I know how tone can be, how much I respect your journey and everything you've been through and all this other stuff. And I know how hard it is. And when you do see things like that, the kind of emotion that can load up. So I love you, that sort of thing. And she's like, well, when I get back from Spain, if I haven't reached out to you, please reach back out to me and we'll have that talk. And I was like, okay, great.
Exactly. And like that, like full, our fear likes to stop us at like, I'm afraid of this. But what happens, even if that happens, then what? Then what? Then what? Then what? Right? Like you sometimes tripping people up is a great way to create belonging.
Yeah, I mean, she engaged my post, right? So that was really what I wanted. I want more of that.
Yeah.
So I needed to, I had to take a step back. I was actually out in Colorado. So I asked my friend, I almost said my friend Laura, because I was talking to Daria about you. My friend Daria, and so she always gives me very candid feedback. I love that about her. I think it's because she's Russian, and I feel like she's like very good.
Yeah, they have a knack for it.
Right. So I was like, hey, I'm like having elevated emotions because of this. And I know I'm like not in the right space. I'm feeling like, you know, I'm being emotionally triggered or whatever. And she's like, yeah, you got to stop making it about yourself.
Yeah. I like
Which
that.
I'm for that.
Yeah.
And so she's like, it's like how that person feels, you know, and she says that in her own way. I'm trying not to interpret her because then I'll have a really bad Russian accent.
Yeah.
And it's not that good. But yeah, that's, I was able to like kind of take that step back and say, okay, she's having emotion thing, but I did want to, what do you think about my reaction to want to kind of save the space online and be like, have a conversation where I'm able to work out like, hey, that's, I redirected her and said, look again. Well, not look again, but something to the effect of, this is where I was going with the post about comparing these costs, but I could see why that would hit you that way. And and I appreciate you saying something about being sensitive, that sort of thing. Like, I appreciate your perspective, that sort of
thing. And that's great.
And, okay. You just think that's great. Cause I was like,
how else are you supposed to handle it?
Well, I did really want, I'm still, the reason for that is because I want the post to hit as many people in a positive light. I wanted to keep the energy of the post.
I think you handled it great. I think you reiterated the message so people who are reading the comments don't get lost. You validated her experience and you, you know, confirmed you heard her. Not like some troll on, like, when I'm not someone who looks through the comments on things, but from what I understand, they feed on each other when you don't respond and handle it. You responded and handled it. Did anyone else come out and be like, yeah, what do you know about eating right and cancer?
No, every other comment after that was just facts or right on or love that or think little squirt.
That's the evidence you need that, like, it was handled really healthy and professionally and, like, authentically.
Yeah, that's the key, right? That's really my when I'm doing getting back onto north or getting my arrow back to north, it's am I being authentic? Am I coming from the heart? Am I coming from a good place?
Yeah.
Right? Because even then, if I make a big mistake, I can always go, oops, I really didn't mean to do anything bad there.
And ultimately, we're all fucking human. Like, expecting ourselves not to make mistakes will create so much friction and so much pressure and so much stress. It's more about how we respond to mistakes. When I was literally reading, like, Gabor Mate's book about, like, the myth of normal, the impact parents have on their children, specifically mothers, like, I had to put it down because it was scaring me about the impact I was going to have on my kid and all the responsibility I would end up having. And I didn't know how to balance that, take care of myself and try and have a business. And then I picked it up again and I read about repair. And that is the fucking point. People are going to get pissed off. We can't undo that because they are always, always, always filtering things to confirm their shit. It's not even about us. But if they do get pissed off, we can clarify authentically, wholeheartedly, we can validate, we can repair, and that repair builds trust.
Yes, exactly. And because I have a lot of long-term relationships, a lot of them. We're talking decades now. I don't want to tell you how many then. But there's some decades in there. And I think that's true because none of those people have been 100% no faults, no vices, no having the outs. There's always been something or other has happened, and you have to repay it.
And
It's true.
if you think about the friendships that haven't lasted decades, I bet they didn't repair. That
That
is
took
literally
under.
the difference. So it's not about screwing up, it's about how you respond when someone misunderstands you. That's really what this is about. And I think, so I want you to sit with it because I want to honor the time, but I think that might need to be where right gets upgraded. Maybe even to purpose. Like, what's the purpose of what I want to say? Understanding people are going to interpret this regardless of how I say it. And if someone interprets it in a way that is not how I intend, I trust myself to handle it authentically and repair so that I'm aligning with the impact I want to have. Like, that is honestly probably a truer statement. In general.
Yeah. No, it goes more to the core of what it is I'm trying to do. Because I'm not necessarily trying to go around doing all the things right. That's
No.
not like that's not the mantra going on in my head. That is definitely under there subconsciously.
Good.
Because I'm like, oh, I want to love people. I want people to feel good. I want to raise that. Can you tell I've been reading the map of consciousness? I want to raise that vibe. I want to raise that energy level up over 200.
It's so great.
Well, it helped me define a lot of things for myself because I'm like, yes, this is what I'm doing. This is exactly what I'm talking about when I talk about energy. But the fact that he just lays it all out and he has scales and
I mean,
measures, cool. Yes.
I literally have it, like, hanging here all the time to, like, see it and remember it because I think it's a phenomenal book. I love that you're reading it. And yeah, I think that it does articulate the, like, what's actually happening energetically very attunely. The last thing I'll leave you with is warning signs. Like,
when you notice the like your body responding to things not being in order, that's a warning sign for you. Like you can let it run its course or you can check in and you can be the conscious, you know, being in that moment.
Yeah, I'm trying to make things right instead, and then I need to look at look at more like purpose.
Yes.
Whether it's wrong or right, but what's the purpose here?
100%. Okay. Let's take a breath. Thank you for answering the questions. I'm glad we got to kind of like close that loop.
Fun.
What would you like to talk about in the podcast today?
Well, I could get my list out, but I can tell you what I've been obsessed about lately, and that is ego.
Okay, tell me more about it. Like what ideas around ego?
Just really what I've been interested in is reacquainting myself with that concept and diving back in after. So there's only so much you can research and shove into your brain at one time. And ego was like kind of at that very virgin, like beginning of this journey of educating myself on things that you might call metaphysical. Would that be a good word for it? And psychology and that sort of thing. So we're talking way back, like in college. And ego was big in psychology around, you know, you're learning about psychology, you're learning about ego, the id, that sort of thing. And then you expand. I remember the Eckhart Tolle books coming out or Eckhart Tolle books coming out and reading those and being, and just like just that little bit of shift and transformation from reading that information and learning more and more about that egoic self. And what that means is that personality that we've all created in order to endure in this individual self that we've created, our personality, our quirks, the way we look, who we are in our society to others.
Okay. So like the greater arch of ego. Curious, when you think about talking about ego, do you go into fear?
Like go into fear. When I talk about ego, oh, I'm more in curiosity right now.
Okay.
Is that what you mean?
Not necessarily. Like the ego uses fear, like that's how it manages us and kind of gets control of the steering wheel.
Okay, yes. So the reason ego comes up for me a lot is every time I have to get on Facebook, I do like to scroll through every once in a while to like people's things. And inevitably, you have to see the garbage that's coming in too. And I see a lot of ego and fear out there. Lots and lots of ego and fear. And some days I'm very like Teflon. And some days something will snap and catch me and I'll ride the train for a little bit. And yeah, it's very much like an ego fear situation. And so I am seeking and I'm curious. Seeking more to reconnect with that definition of ego and reminding myself of that illusion of separateness. And that we really are all one thing happening right now. Because there is grounding and peace in that.
Thank you for joining me on today's episode of The Challenges of Change. If you're ready to stop stressing and reclaim your sense of worth, be sure to visit my website at www.changebychallenge.com. There, you'll find loads of resources, blog posts, and information on how to work with me, Tora, as your personal mindset coach. Remember, if it doesn't challenge you, it won't change you. Don't let burnout or any other obstacle hold you back from living your best life. Take the first steps towards positive transformation today. Thank you again for listening. Stay confident, stay inspired, and embrace the challenges of change. Until next time.